Sorry. Leave the words up. That time, like, Jesus paid it all. All in him. You're gonna owe some money over Jesus. The world's coming to collect. Jesus said here, it's all grace. For Jesus, I ask you today, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that Lord, there be a complete surrender to Jesus. Lord, even take all my orneriness. Lord, help us to surrender to you. Let us hear the words of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, guide us into all truth today. And Lord, I also pray that you would make us relentless evangelists by the end of this message. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
This morning, before we get into the word, I want to just announce to you, does anybody here remember Vic Poco? Vic used to come and sit right here, and he'd have an oxygen tank with him, and Vic went home to meet Jesus. I believe it was Christmas Eve. And so his funeral is going to be Tuesday, the 29th. The visitation is between 4 and 7 in Twin Lakes. The Hazy Lockwood Funeral Home in Twin Lakes, and then there will be a service at 7 o'clock. Pastor John will be officiating. So just be aware of that. And Lord, we lift Karen up. She has been a precious wife to Vic. She has been watching over him through a long illness. And Lord, she has done an amazing job loving and caring for him. And Father, I just pray for that family, that your Holy Spirit will come and comfort them. And Lord, one thing we know is Vic is in the world. And have all his pain and gone, his suffering. And so, Father, just watch out for the family now. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. This morning, the title is How Jesus Saves. How Jesus Saves. Interesting to me where our world has gone. Has anybody here seen It's a Wonderful Life? It's a Wonderful Life. Do you know, I think that was, I can't remember if it was made in 55 or 46 or 48, but it was made before I was born or when I was born. 47? All right. Here's the thing. Capra made that because he wanted to fight the growth of atheism. I heard that on Moody Radio yesterday. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that prophetic? He saw, back then, he saw atheism growing, and so he made that movie trying to call attention to God. Look where we are today. This morning I want to study salvation, how Jesus saves. I'm not going to talk to you about the time that you're redeemed and the process, you know, the process that you go through of sanctification and glorification. Those are all great terms. I love the study of salvation. I'm going to keep this so simple this morning. But I want to talk to you about the process you go through. There's three R's. We have a restore, rebuild, and a repay fund here. That's not what this is about. But there's three R's this morning. And the R's are this: revelation, response, and results. The outline's a little different. No blanks to fill in this morning. There's a scripture text you can write next to it. You can take notes next to it. When it comes to being saved, the first thing is you have to learn about Jesus. There's a revelation phase where you find out who Jesus is, who God is. I love the Christmas story, and the characters in the Christmas story, I believe, had faith in Jesus Christ. They had faith in God the Father, and therefore they didn't know Jesus yet, so they had faith. And Jesus was about to be revealed to them. I wonder where you're at in the process of salvation this morning. You should have had revelation of who Jesus is, but I'm here to tell you, you can learn more. So revelation, how does it happen? There are several in the Christmas story we're going to cover. We've kind of covered them already, but if you tell somebody something twice, they have a better chance of remembering it. So the first one in the revelation phase of coming to salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ, Luke chapter 1, verses 11 through 17, the angel of the Lord appeared to him. If you're writing notes, put alongside of there, angel is a messenger. The angel of the Lord appeared to him standing at the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah." If a being from another world appears to you and you're afraid and he doesn't say, "Do not be afraid," you probably should be very, very afraid. But the angels always say, "Do not be afraid." And then he says, "Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink." I love this. "He will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. Many of the people of Israel he will bring back to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, and to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." I got distracted there because I was thinking of how our world needs to know and come to turn the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous. He's going to come in the spirit of Elijah. This is revelation from the angel that the Messiah is coming. Zechariah is being told, "Your boy is going to be the prophet of the Most High God." And the angel brings revelation. If we move ahead in verses 26 through 33 of the text, and this is the announcement to Mary that she's going to have a baby, again from an angel. "In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David." Again, that tells you the Savior's coming. "The virgin's name was Mary, and the angel went to her and said, 'Greetings, you who are highly favored.' Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will never end." Again, revelation from the angel of the Lord. Do you know that in the Middle East right now there are angels appearing to people telling them about Jesus? Remember when we had visitors here from Turkey, and they said Jesus actually appeared to a lady at a border when she was crossing into Turkey, and he was holding a book, and he was shining bright, and they got to tell her, "That's Jesus, that's your Savior." In the revelation phase, an angel can come and speak to you. There's revelation from the Lord. It's in the Christmas story. Joseph got revelation from an angel. Mary got revelation. People got revelation. The shepherds get revelation from the angels. People won't be saved without revelation. Do you remember when there was revelation for you about who Jesus Christ is? It started for me on the roof of a pole barn, pulling nails, taking a pole barn apart. And my brother-in-law and I began speaking about the Bible. And can you trust it? I had a big old pro by pulling it. Big long pole barn. God began to reveal himself. The next one in Luke chapter 2, verses 17 and 18, when the shepherds had heard that Jesus was born, it says when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. Revelation comes from the human testimony, from the word of mouth. How is somebody going to learn about Jesus if we won't tell them? And what's the world doing today? They're trying to keep you quiet. I talked to somebody this morning that's a teacher who said, you know, somebody asked her a question about fasting. And she began to tell the students, and then she began to wonder, will I get in trouble for this? You see, the world's trying to say, don't talk about Jesus. Don't talk about your faith. You could get in trouble. You could offend somebody. Be quiet. Shh. You know why? Because the enemy knows if they get revelation of who Jesus is, they might wind up getting saved. From human testimony. Do you remember when you were first saved? When I was first saved, I was crazy, man. I told everybody about Jesus. I want some of that back with what I know now. All the young guys that came to work for us on the farm, I told them about Jesus. I would say, you know what faith is? And I'd quote Hebrews to them about faith, and they would look at me like, can't we just go on sweeping the granary? And I would tell them, this is what faith is, man. You got to put faith in Jesus. And you know what I realized several years after my craziness? They all came to faith in Jesus Christ. One by one, they started to confess. I would get calls from their parents going, what happened to my kid? I would say, he's okay. Just put his faith in Jesus Christ. It's human testimony. Listen to what Romans says in chapter 10 about this. Romans chapter 10, verses 14 through 18. How then can they call on the one who they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one in whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Not all Israelites accept the good news, for Isaiah said, Lord, who has believed our message? Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. Are you willing to speak to people about Jesus? Do you look for an opening? I look for an opening. I don't try to kick doors down, but man, when I have a chance to put Jesus in there, I do it. Because they have to get into this phase. They have to get the revelation of who Jesus is. And I'm so upset today because they have such a wrong perception of my Savior. Years ago, I was at this seminar helping you discover your spiritual gifts. Where do you fit in the body of Christ? And one of the best exercises I've ever done is they said, we want to know what your passion in life is. And man, I took all this time and I filled out all these papers. And I still remember it today. I think I can just say it almost word for word. What I wrote down, my passion in life is to paint an authentic picture of Jesus Christ using words. I'm so tired of an unauthentic, a counterfeit Jesus that's being preached. And you have to have revelation of who the real Jesus is. So when you believe in the one true God and you really are saved and you wind up in heaven with him.
Hallelujah.
Revelation. The next one's awesome. Luke chapter 2 verses 25 through 26. And this is from Simeon. And here's how he found out. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon who was righteous and devout, and he was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Christ. There comes revelation from the Spirit of God. I don't believe you can get saved without the Holy Spirit being in it, and he comes and he reveals Jesus. One of the big first books I ever read about salvation was when the Holy Spirit, they said, has a big spotlight like he's in Hollywood. And he keeps holding the light on Jesus, so all you can see is Jesus. And the
Holy Spirit brought revelation. He said this to Simeon. He said, you will see the Savior before you die. The Holy Spirit tricked me when I got saved. He said, if you just read the Bible to find out all about Jesus, all these people are there telling you about Jesus, you can tell them, I read that book, it's over now, leave me alone. And so I said, great, man. I started digging into the scriptures and reading the gospels, and I'm still reading the gospels because it just caught me. But why was I caught? Because of the revelation of who Jesus really is. The toughest guy that ever walked on the face of the earth, but the gentlest, most loving, and caring. Wow. And I don't ever want to get away from him. See, revelation. When you're witnessing to people, bring proper, authentic revelation of who Jesus is to them. Forget about, you know, correcting them and telling them, now if you do this and you have to do that, you know, and they go, oh man, get me out of here. Just say, do you know what Jesus would do here? Do you know what he's like? And bring revelation. The Spirit does it. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, very simple, but you remember the star. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, the Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who is born King of the Jews? We have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. Woo! What a way for Herod to find out there was another king in town. A star. Anybody hang around with junior high kids? There's always that one, Pastor, what about the guy that lives out in the jungle who will never hear about Jesus? I used to say, go find him for me, ask him if he's ever heard about Jesus, and then it's too late. He just heard. But you see, what we don't realize, that's a question that the enemy keeps bringing up to try to tell us God's not fair. That's not right. God is all powerful. He can use a star. He can use anything to reveal Jesus to you. They're not going to be able to get to heaven or, you know, in front of the judgment seat and go, oh, I didn't know, Lord. He's going to go, oh, wait a minute here. Revelation. The next one is about the same. Romans chapter 1. Verses 18 through 20, I love this. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. That's the opposite of revelation. They suppress the truth. The enemy doesn't want you to know about Jesus. Since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. Ask your neighbor, how? For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his internal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. You ever see the face of a Cali dog? Anybody here? Hope I'm not the only one. You ever take time to look at that face? How do the different colors of the hair get in there and how are they marked out? It just blew me away one day. I had 200 Holstein cows. And I tried to find two with the exact marks. It's not there, folks. Because there's a creator. When you put seed in the ground, how does it come out? By God. All things, all creation. Everything going on out there, it screams about a creator. It's a revelation of Jesus Christ. He was there when it all happened. And you have to have revelation. Just in the Christmas story, and I think I've missed a bunch of them. Angels are messengers. There's human testimony. It's the power of the Holy Spirit. It's the star. It's all of creation. It cries out for Jesus. And I got one more I want you to write down there. A life. A life brings revelation of Jesus Christ.
When I first got saved, all my relatives were waiting for that phase or that fad or that new thing to wear off on me so I could get back to drinking and having fun. That's literally what they said. I think they've given up. They might think I've gone the wrong way. Look at John the Baptist. Isn't it interesting? Before he was born, it says he'll be filled with the Spirit. That he'll be the prophet of the Most High God. And I think some of those people sat there and they were waiting to see. We'll see what happens. 30 years later, there's a voice crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Every valley shall be exalted. Every hill will be made low. And his life brought revelation of who Jesus was. He said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Nobody will get saved if there's not revelation of who Jesus Christ is. And they're writing books and they're teaching classes about how to save souls and do this. And it's so simple to me. There has to be revelation of who the real Jesus is. And he's irresistible. And I want to spend my life trying to show people the real Jesus. Not the one that you're finding fault with and you're upset with because you don't know him. If you really know him, you fall in love with him forever. It's my prayer this morning that your life will bring revelation to the real Jesus. People are watching. I've preached more sermons without speaking a word. By just not losing it, you know. Everybody's sitting there waiting to see. He's going to lose it. He's going to lose it. The Spirit of God says, don't lose it, man. Model Jesus. Model his life. Don't take vengeance. Model Jesus. So powerful.
So the first part of being saved and how somebody's going to get saved is there has to be revelation. Try to recognize where people are that you're witnessing to and just keep bringing revelation of who Jesus really is. The next is the person's response. The person's response. We're going back to Luke now, chapter 1, and Zechariah's response, okay, verses 18 through 20. Zechariah asked the angel, how can I be sure of this? Zechariah and Mary both said, how? He says, I'm an old man. My wife's well along in the years. The angel answered, I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God and I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their proper time. His response was doubt. He wasn't sure. Now let me ask you a question. How do you think the next 9 months went for Zechariah? He could not speak. It says he came out of the temple making signs to the people going, a big angel man. And he went for 9 months not being able to talk, and he didn't have an Etch-a-Sketch or an iPad to type to what's going on. And you know what it is? It's inconvenient and it's frustrating when you don't believe and you doubt God. Now there's a good thing I think about it. You know what I'd like to find? I'd like for archaeology to find Zechariah's notes. You ever think about that? You see if you sit and think about this stuff long enough. Wow! You can find a note where he said, his name will be John. And everybody would say, oops, I guess that might be true. But don't forget the point here, right down there. Doubt makes life inconvenient and frustrating. It really does. Every time I doubt God, I'm frustrated and I get a little bit uptight. And if I just go, hey God, it's up to you, deal with it. Faith Look at the next response from Mary, verses 34 through 38 here. Mary says, "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "Since I am a virgin." And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. She who was said to be barren in her 6th month, for nothing is impossible with God." Listen to the response. "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." And then the angel left her. Look at the difference in the responses. When you look at the difference of the responses with Zechariah not believing it was going to happen, and then look at Mary saying, "Let it be done to me according to thy will." Look at the difference in the miracles. Zechariah just had to go home and love his wife. That's what he had to do. And he goes, "Oh, this can't happen." Mary had never been with a man, and he said, "You're going to get pregnant." She goes, "Okay." Total submission to the will of God. Total submission to the will of God. What's your response to the revelation of Jesus Christ? Is it submission or, "Man, I don't know"? The one that gets me is, "Well, can God do that?" Can He? Watch this, man. Of course He can. Chapter 2 and verse 15, I want you to see what the shepherds do when the angel makes the announcement and the revelation. "When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, 'Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about.'" If you're taking notes, write down an investigation. I hear it all the time from people. "Well, you Christians, and the Bible says, and you know, it doesn't, not relevant." And then I ask them a question. I say, "Have you read Scripture? Have you read the Bible?" Well, no, I don't read Scripture. I mean, the book is so old. It's been translated so many times. You know. And I say, "Would you mind just, like, reading what God says about this?" You know, most of the time when somebody will investigate, the shepherds said, "Let's go see." The shepherds could have stayed in the field and said, "Well, somebody's got to watch the sheep. You go, now you go, you go." They all said, "Hey, let's go." But it's investigation. Isn't that how the Holy Spirit got me? He said, "Just look into it, read it, and then you'll know for yourself." You can tell all the people I know that, "Don't worry about it." Man, the more I investigated, the more I fell in love. When those guys walked into that stable and they saw the face of baby Jesus, they were like, "Whoa! It's real!" I had a guy when I was a kid, I was in the process of salvation. I had not accepted Christ yet. I went to a prayer meeting with my wife. I took her there. I was going to grab her and get out of there in time I could go bowling. And I saw this guy, and this guy was like me. In high school, we used to fight over a position. One of us was going to be the 5th man on the team in our high school basketball team. And we used to fight for a position every weekend and try to show the coach, "I should start this team." And we would come out of practice and we would be bloody, man, all over. And the coach took us aside one day and he said, "You two guys got to calm down a little bit." "Hey, man, I'm going to start." He said, "On the bench." But the first prayer we had, he looked at me and he said, "Dave, I gotta tell you, this thing's working hard." He said, "Salvation is real." And I looked at him and I went, "Thank God, he's cussing me." And I would cuss at him and we would kick each other, bite each other, anything it took to win. And he said, "I'm gonna turn it out, Dave.
investigate and look into it. The more you read Scripture, the more you find out, the more you believe. Don't sit there and go, well, as soon as I see and I know it all, then I'll believe. God says you walk by faith, not by sight. There's revelation and there's investigation. Look into it. If you're not sure about it, look into it. Challenge the people you witness to. Hey, just read this Scripture and look into it. Speak the Scripture to them. They'll never be able to forget. It will haunt them the rest of the day. And get them to investigate. The shepherds investigate.
There's another response, Matthew chapter 2 and verse 3. Matthew 2, verse 3, it was a response of Herod. When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed in all Jerusalem with him.
He was disturbed. You know what happens when you reject Jesus? When you reject and oppose Jesus, you're disturbed. Your life is disturbed. Do you know anybody running away from God? Do you know anybody who goes, yeah, I know he says that, but I think I'm just going to do this anyway, you know, and I got time to get it all straight. You know what their life is? Their life is disturbed. There's no peace. There's guilt and there's shame. And they're disturbed like Herod was. It says, Herod and all of Jerusalem was disturbed. Why? Because they were opposed to the Savior. They had revelation. Look at how he did it. The star brought the Magi, and the Magi said to Herod, hey, King of the Jews has been born, and he was disturbed. And he didn't stop there. Then there was total opposition. Matthew chapter 2 and verse 16, look at what it says. When Herod realized he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious, and he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under in accordance to the time he had learned from the Magi. He decided he wanted to kill God. You know, you rub shoulders with people every day to kill God. They're trying to get God out of the schools. They're trying to get him out of the courts. They're trying to get him out of your life. They're trying to kill God. And you know what? It leaves people disturbed, messed up. There will never be peace in the cities in the United States of America. They won't recognize God. There will be nothing but turmoil and more of what we're seeing over and over and over. I meet people all the time. You mention God, you get mad, and you walk away. Whew. I used to look out and look around and say, you can see by my stomach, I used to look out. I used to say to somebody there, do you know about God? And then you go, oh, I like this. And you just want to, you know, I'm going to start. The first step is revelation. You know who Christ really is. The second step is your response. What's your response? What's their response? And then there's the response. Back to the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 1. In verse 49, Luke chapter 1, and verse 49, Mary says, for the mighty one has done great things for me, and holy is his name. What changed you? What happened to you? What got into you? You used to do this. You used to do that. The mighty one. Verses 67 through 69, this is Zechariah after he gets his voice back. The minute he wrote down his name will be John, he could speak. His father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come and has redeemed his people. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. Salvation through a Savior. Anybody here ever dehorn cattle? They're a tough, man. You get hit by one of those horns on those cattle and it hurts. And I love the this thing real, will you really be saved by the grace of God, and it'll last for the eternity. The horn of salvation, that was the result, is salvation through Jesus. The next one, Luke chapter 2, verses 29 through 32, and again, this is Simeon. As soon as I find it here. Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. We have to stop there. One of the results of salvation, when there's revelation and the proper response, you're not afraid to die. Simeon says, hey Lord, now I can go home in peace. Why? Because I've seen him. He was holding Jesus. My eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people, Israel. Right there is revelation. And he saw Jesus and he said, I'm not afraid. I was talking to Pastor John. This story over and over. I was at the bedside of a lady in her 90s, and I sat there and I prayed for about 40 minutes. She had gone to sleep, and when she woke up, she opened her eyes and she looked at me and she went, oh, darn. She wanted to go to sleep with me. And she was so disappointed to see me. You see, she wasn't afraid to die. She longed to be Jesus. Simeon says, Lord, now I get the part in peace. I'm not afraid. I mean, I don't want to die. I want to grow old and see my grandkids get married. It sounds like fun, but I'm not afraid. Because my last breath here and my next breath with Jesus, I have it on the authority of the Word of God. It's powerful. The results are so powerful. John chapter 5 and verse 24, I just absolutely love this text lately. Jesus says, do not be amazed. Wait a minute. I've got to back up. I tell you the truth. Whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has what? Eternal life and will not be condemned. You should all shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. For he has crossed over from death to life. In an instant, one minute you're going to die and be apart from God. And when you put your faith in him now, you're going to die and be with him for glory. What a deal. And the results are amazing, but on the negative side, they're so bad. Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 11. Anybody know the Roman road? I love it. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Is that all there is to it? That's where it starts right there, folks. You got to confess with your mouth. It is with your heart that you believe and are justified. It is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. As the scripture says, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame. I absolutely love that. Because I put my hope in Christ. The reward is me. Told you that all the young guys that worked for us, they came to a place where they came to faith in Christ. And one young man, there's this 90-degree angle, this hairpin turn by where I live, and he was there one day, and he was heading to school. And he went around this curb, and he hit some ice in the wintertime, and he went off the road and rolled his truck. Different. see, he had revelation from a crazy farmer that he worked with. And he knew there was salvation, and he knew there was something more. And then, when he almost lost it, he's like, okay, this is it, man. I'm in. I'd like to stop there. But then I would declare to you the whole counsel of God. Matthew chapter 2, verse 19. Just going to read three words. Then Herod died. He died. If you don't have the right response, you get the wrong result. Herod was disturbed. He sent the soldiers to kill all the boys in Bethlehem. He was going to wipe God out. And that's all it says. It says, Herod died. Apart from God. You do a Bible study, it says a lot about heaven. It says heaven's a place where there's no pain, no sorrow. There's a banquet table there. You're with Jesus. You don't need the Son because Jesus is there. It's a place that's just awesome, folks. The Apostle Paul said, I can't even begin to describe it to you. He says, the eye hasn't seen, the ear hasn't heard, it hasn't begun to enter the heart of man. What God has prepared for those who love him. Wow. The right response gets you the right result. But you know what the other side of it is? There's a place called hell. It's a place of outer darkness where there's weeping and there's gnashing of teeth. It says the fire never goes out and your worm never dies. If you really look it up, it means you have a personal maggot that eats on you for eternity and you're never consumed. It never stops. You're in an eternal garbage dump. And you're apart from God. You know what else I've learned from reading scripture about hell? I think the rub on hell is that before you go there, you come before the throne of Almighty God and you see God in all his glory and you see what you could have had and then you are taken away for eternity knowing what you missed. And I'm here this morning giving you a revelation. Don't miss it. Is what you do in 70 or 80 years of your life worth blowing eternity with Christ? Father, we come this morning, Lord. Lord, if there's one in here that's never had revelation, let them know the one true Jesus is very dead. And Lord, if there's one that's never had a good response, they've never come back and said, Lord, do it unto me according to thy will. Lord, let it be today. Let today be the day of salvation so that, Lord, they can have the right result and wind up in eternity with you, Father. Lord, don't let them leave today until they come here. They kneel down before you. They humble themselves before you. And they meet the one true Christ and they live an authentic Christian life and they have the results of peace that passes understanding. Then, Lord, help us to understand how it happens that there has to be revelation. Give us patience, Lord, in witnessing. Let us portray the real, true Jesus to those around us. And then, Lord, let us wait patiently and pray for their response. And help us to keep Jesus in front of them. Because, Lord, if we do that, the result is going to be we're going to spend eternity with those folks. I almost forgot this, but I said, anybody see
the movie Dakota when he caught it. Dolly Parton's old, old song I used to listen to in the tractor. What would end on this? I really have good stuff. I can do this all day. I love this. Her dad came to church, but never went into church. I understand that he was afraid of what they'd do to him. But one day he walked in and he tried to say to his wife, "I love you," you know, like, isn't that enough? And I love her response. She said, "That's not enough." She said, "I know you love me, but that's not enough because that means we can be together here on earth." But she goes, "I'm not afraid of eternity." I was like, am I really seeing this on television today? Yeah! He walked up to the altar and he said, "All right, I assume that. I give up." And then, you know, they dropped short, man. A prayer of salvation, that would have been fun. The results are amazing, folks. It's an eternity that we can be together. Father, take your word this morning. Let it accomplish in us what you sent it for. Lord, for those who are getting weary, man, they're trying to bring revelation and people are spitting in their face. Lord, help us to wipe our face off today, clean up, and go right back at it. Lord, help us to pray for the response and help us to partake of the results. In your precious name, amen. Amen. If you need prayer, I'd love to pray for you. If you have questions, I'd love to try to answer them with God's word. Now you're free to go in peace to the lovely servant of the Lord. Merry Christmas. God bless you. Have a happy New Year.